Shalom lekulam.
Hello everyone. In 4 days' time, we will be commemorating 7 years of the Oslo Agreement, and after that, we will also be marking 20 years the second Intifada, the Al-Aqsa Intifada. And looking back, the changes in the Palestinian theater are apparent, and alongside with it, the changes in the Israeli-Palestinian relations and this entire dialogue between them on the resolution of the conflict, or at least an arrangement of sorts. And in order to have a better insight about the present, but also to discuss the future scenarios and what Israel is required to do, we will be hosting Mr. Yoram Cohen, former head of the ISA between 2011 and 2016. And correct me if I'm wrong, Yoram, you have almost 40 years of personal experience in the Palestinian theater. And with you, Yoram, we will try to touch upon the developments of the Palestinian theater and its context on what is happening to us. And before we delve deep into the Palestinian theater, we'd like to hear from you, Yoram, the story of the envelope, of the surroundings, what happens in the region in general, and how these developments impact the present and future of the Palestinians. The main thing, I think, is that we have had a big shock wave here in the Middle East, perhaps not unprecedented, historically speaking, but it is very intense. The phenomena we have come to know over the last few years of countries and states collapsing, the use of violence in a way of controlling by means of doing this, and if we have Daesh, for example, if we have ISIS, if we have issues of control internally, this has to do with unemployment, with the absence of financial engines and drivers, and with little control of the public. And this all reflects upon a phenomenon, or projects upon a phenomenon, that perhaps has the characteristics of chronic instability in the Middle East. Not all countries suffer from it, but some of them do. We saw it in Lebanon, Syria, Iraq, Yemen. There were some countries that were on the brink, that they underwent some turmoil and they got back to themselves, sort of regrouped quite quickly. All of these lead to the idea, to deep thought in Israel and also in Arab countries, mostly the moderate ones, about how national interests should be handled, how collaborations should happen. If we look at Iran, for example, and all of its proxies, whether it's Shiite sectors and supporters, and also their strategic support of their desires, also the need and the desire to have a national control, those who have alliances and connections with huge empires like the United States that are a little bit further away, perhaps they're thinking of different solutions, and also the solutions that I find all the more important that have to do with agriculture, health, tourism, financial prosperity, a situation where we can create a better future, because we realize that continuing with the current situation for another 50 years will lead nowhere. In our context, I think that the phenomenon in the last 10 years, the developments, most of them beyond the relations between Israel and countries that we did not have relations with, And that peaked with the accord with the UAE that will be signed in a few days. And all the other areas, the negative ones, Iran, Syria, Iraq, and so on, have created, in terms of our security policy, fearing that we will be signing agreements with those who will no longer have control, like the Palestinian Authority, and also problems in adjacent and neighboring countries. A situation where we must actually trust ourselves from our borders have led us and have led Israel to think and rethink the security arrangements we will be doing on our borders and in our concessions, and also in the Palestinian theater itself. And by the way, if I were to look, if I were to take your analysis, Yoram, what we need to understand, or what a Palestinian should understand, is that their issue has become much more marginal, much more negligent in the regional outlook. They can no longer be the bargaining chip they used to be in the past. I think it's true, and it's no new. It's not new. It's just intensifying. I think that even if the Israeli party is making mistakes, when it comes to the negotiations with the Palestinians, there are several issues that are perhaps debatable, but I find are facts. There were three rounds of peace talks that were very important at very high levels and were documented. The main negotiation round following Oslo, of course, was between Prime Minister Barak and Yasser Arafat. And at the end of those talks in Y, in the summer of 2000, a certain decision was placed on the table. The Israelis said yes, perhaps they had some reservations, but they said yes, and the Palestinians said no. Years later, Olmert had talks with Abu Mazen, and they came close to an arrangement, even if it was only highlights, if it was only headings, but they came close, and then the Americans were made privy of the details, but Abu Mazen said no, and he said, let me think about it, and he's still thinking about it. And the third round was during the Obama-Kerry administration with Netanyahu and Tzipi Livni, and again it was with Abu Mazen, and it didn't reach the same height as the previous two, but again there was a draft, there was an agreement by the Americans on the table, and Israel has said yes, and Abu Mazen has yet to give a positive response. So when it comes to an American or other offer being placed on the table, the Palestinians either did not respond or said no. That has to be said. And time is going by, and the ethnic security based and other challenges are taking over, like the economic, so it also should be taken into effect. And once these knock on our doors, these challenges, and once they realize that there's no progress being made with the Palestinians, there's no negotiation with Israel, they're not willing to compromise, the Palestinian issue is turning the entire Arab Muslim world, particularly in the Middle East, they're taking them hostage. And when they look at things, when they look at the cost-effectiveness, they are now looking for a new paradigm, perhaps finding a different solution, a different arrangement that will maybe not be perfect for either party, but will allow us to develop normalization and to live together. So if I were to take the bottom line of what you've just said, Yoram, and if I were to try and see and try and look at the other alternatives the Palestinians have, if you look at the discourse between Palestinians, particularly in the last few years, you get a sense of a multidimensional crisis. They seem far away from any objective they had ever set for themselves, whether it is their own internal peace, internal reconciliation, the idea of the one state instead of the two states. How do you see the alternatives the Palestinians have and are faced with? And what's more important, Yoram, and here I'd be happy to hear your approach, what are the implications for us? And what would you recommend we do vis-a-vis these scenarios? Well, regardless of the fact that there is no productive negotiation, no productive talks happening between Israeli and Palestinian leaders, which is terrible, but that is the current situation. Even if these negotiations were to be renewed between whatever leaders, if the positions remain the same, if the situation remains the same, with Gaza having no solution, of the authority of the Palestinian Authority taking over, no one is going to take it over. It will continue to be a kind of foreign entity, and the West Bank being the source of the arrangement, I think that we should be reaching an agreement with the Palestinians in every area and not to try and overtake them. They are a big organization, and I would say that this is an objective that is certainly a top priority. But in the absence of such an option of getting towards an agreement or an understanding or arrangement, I think we should be looking at these areas that play a big part. I think it it is currently non-realistic and perhaps even dangerous to aspire to a two-state solution. A, because of what we've experienced in Gaza. B, because we don't want Hamas to win elections in the West Bank, and for other reasons as well. I think it is non-realistic. Also because of their financial stability and robustness, it is not realistic to aspire. It is also dangerous to aspire to it and to strive for it, because the Palestinian security mechanisms, even if they are working for the Palestinians or for us, they cannot provide the kind of productivity that we want, the kind of input that we are expecting from them. They cannot create it. The second thing is the other solution, which is, I mean, if there's one kind of danger or hazard, this is another disaster. And that is to sort of go down the slippery slope of a one-state solution. I think that'll really put an end to the Zionist vision. We are currently in a situation that is problematic, but if we get a situation where the population is 50-50, 50% hostile, I'm not talking about the Israeli Arabs, who are not hostile, but I'm talking about 3 million Palestinians in the West Bank and 2 million in the Gaza Strip and 7 million Israelis. This is not good. And in any aspect, whether it's demographic or international or in terms of equality or in terms of the life fabric and way of life, it's not reasonable. So I'm thinking that what is reasonable to say is that we're not going to be a one state or two states, we're going towards the, let's say, realistic objective for the next 10 or 20 years. And that is, at the top, at the most can be an autonomy plus or a state minus, because that's the most we can do. And what can be done until then? I think that, okay, some might say, but that's reality today. But it's not, because we can offer the Palestinians many things that do not impede our security, do not set a problem for the settlements, but we can also offer them. I think that Israel can offer the Palestinians a territorial contiguity in Area A, roads, bridges. I think Israel can also take steps that will improve the financial aspect, the financial climate in the Palestinian Authority, perhaps the passages in Tarkumia in Bejalabe, perhaps to connect them to railways that will get them to our Israeli ports in Ashdod and in Haifa. Work can improve, and also the passages to Jordan. We can improve transportation. We can improve construction. I don't think it's a problem for Israel to say that Kalkilia or Tulkarem will be expanded eastwards. It has no impact on Route 6 or on the Israeli communities, Jewish communities. We can offer them a lot of things without reaching the final agreement and say that's it, no one has any more claims. Maybe we won't reach a final agreement, but we will be able to lead to our neighbors being happier, being more comfortable. They will invest more in education, they will invest more in employment, and at the same time continue with all the security aspects, not to hand over responsibility for the security to anyone else until the situation improves. The better they'll be, the less we'll have to do. But if they can't do it, we have to continue taking this on and not to have any harm done to other Jewish communities. So we can have work in Israel, we can have economic levers, maybe marine, maybe rentis, gas, trains. There are areas which we can improve for them that do not impede Israel's security, that do not have a negative effect on Israeli Jewish communities. It's something we can do, and they also don't stop any prices or any bargaining chips that we will have to be discussing in the negotiations. Some people are saying, let's leave these offers and before for the negotiations on a final agreement, but it's not happening, so we should maybe do that now. So you're talking about an interim agreement that is somewhere on the spectrum, somewhere on the range between the current situation and the long-term final agreement. Yes, because a final solution is not currently realistic. I mean, I don't think the Palestinians will not be putting down their weapons and saying, let's become part of Israel. This nightmare frightens me just as much, not just because of security reasons. I think that we should avoid going to those places. We shouldn't have two sovereign independent states, but we also shouldn't have a single state. We must separate from the Palestinians, and even though physically it's difficult, at least functionally, we should separate from them in parameters, in institutions, in establishments, in economy, to make sure that no one else is harmed, but everyone's interests are maintained. But we also have to make sure our security is intact. And if we hand over responsibilities fully, Israeli citizens will not be secure. Yoram, some people say that we have come to the point of no return. You think that we are still only close to it, but we haven't gotten there yet? I actually think it's far off. I have said over the last few months that annexation should not happen, not a 40% annexation. I was against that because it will really shatter the dream and will not allow for any future solution. But if they were to go to a block annexation solution and to give the Palestinians an alternative, different lands, swapping lands, that perhaps will not provide a solution, but I think it will at least be done with an understanding, because they understand that these blocks will be part of Israel. So to do things unilaterally, that shouldn't be done. We should do it together. And if we can't do things together, we should take steps to improve their lives as our neighbors. Yoram, I'd like to thank you for a discussion that was not trivial, but also quite profound. And I'd like to wish us all a happy, sweet, healthy Jewish New Year. And from here, we're going to move on to an interview with Philippe Herrera, Director General for Political Affairs and Security at the French Ministry of Foreign Affairs, who will give us the international aspects of the Palestinian theater, and he will be speaking to Major General in Reserves Amos Gilad.